Hachette Audio presents Ruination, a League of Legends novel. Written by Anthony Reynolds. Read by James Patrick Cronin, Misty Lee, Sean J. Teale, Mara Junot, Mark Oliver, Dave B. Mitchell, Scott McNeil, Carol Valença, André Sogliuzzo, Debra Wilson, Steve French, Lisa Lindsley, Rick Zieff, Joe J. Thomas, Ellen Dubin, Jay Preston, Paul Bellantoni, Patty Mattson, Daniel Riordan, Dan Bittner, and Sarah Sampino.
Invariably, all nations crumble, fall, and are forgotten. And in their final death throes, they often drag others down with them.
The Histories of Empire, Volume 6, by Tyrus of Helia. Prologue. Helia, the Blessed Isles. Urlok Grail stood separate from his peers, awaiting the choosing. They waited within a small open-air amphitheater, the architecture all gleaming white marble and gold-encased capstones. Helia wore its opulence proudly, as if in defiance of the brutalities of life beyond the shores of the Blessed Isles. The others joked and laughed together, their collective nervousness drawing them closer. Yet Grail stood silent and alone, his gaze intense. No one spoke to him or included him in any of the whispered japes. Few even registered his presence, their gazes slipped over and around him as if he didn't exist. To most of them, he didn't. Grail did not care. He had no desire to swap inane small talk with them, and he felt no jealousy at their juvenile camaraderie. Today would be his moment of triumph. Today he would be embraced into the inner circle, apprenticed within the secretive upper echelons of the Fellowship of Light. He had more than earned his place there. No other student present came close. They might hail from wealth and nobility, while he came from a line of illiterate pig farmers, but none were as gifted or as worthy as he. The masters arrived, filing down the central stairs one by one, silencing the gaggle of hopefuls. Grail watched them, eyes burning with a hungry light. He licked his lips, savoring the prestige and glory that were soon to be heaped upon him, anticipating all the secrets that he would soon be privy to. The masters shuffled into place upon the lower tiers of the amphitheater, their expressions solemn, staring down at the cluster of adepts on the floor below them. Finally, after an overlong pause to build suspense, a pompous, toad-like master, his skin pale and wet-looking, Elder Bartek, cleared his throat and welcomed the graduating students. His verbose speech was heavy with gravitas and self-congratulatory asides, and Grail's eyes glazed over. Finally, the time came for the masters to choose which of the graduates would be taken under their wing as apprentices. There were leaders here from all the major disciplines and denominations of the fellowship. They represented the arcanic sciences, the various schools of logic and metaphysics, the blessed archives, the astro scryers, hermetic oratory, esoteric geometry, the seekers, and other branches of study. All served in one way or another the greater purpose of the fellowship. The gathering, study, cataloging, and securing of the most powerful arcane artifacts in existence. It was an auspicious gathering of some of the world's most brilliant minds. Yet Urlok Grail focused on only one of their number. Hierarch Malgurza, Master of the Key. Her dark skin was heavily lined, and her once ebony hair was now mostly gray. Malgurza was a legend among the adepts of Helia. She didn't appear at every year's choosing ceremony, but when she did, it was always to embrace a new apprentice into the inner circle. The baton of choosing was brought forth. It was passed, first, to Hierarch Malgirza, the most honored master present. She took it in one gnarled hand, causing a ripple of murmurs among the students. Malgirza would indeed choose an apprentice this day, and the ghost of a smile curled Grail's thin lips. The elderly woman cast her hawkish gaze across the gathered hopefuls who held their breaths as one. Whoever was named would be marked for greatness, joining a hallowed elite cadre, their future assured. Erlach Grail's fingers twitched in anticipation. This was his moment. He was already half-stepping forward when the Hierarch finally spoke, her voice husky, like oak-aged spirits.
Tyrus of Hellismore.
Grail blinked. For a second, he thought there must have been some mistake before the cold reality of his rejection washed over him, like a bucket of frigid water to the face. There was a delighted whoop from the chosen student, along with a burst of whispers and gasps. The newly named apprentice stepped forward amid a flurry of slaps on the back and ran up the steps of the amphitheater to take his place behind Hierarch Malgirza, a broad smile on his smug face. Grail made no outward reaction, though he had gone dangerously still. The rest of the ceremony went by in a dull, surreal blur. The baton of choosing passed from master to master, each choosing a new apprentice. Name by name, the crowd of hopefuls around Grail dwindled until he stood alone. The sea of masters and former peers stared down at him like a jury ready to announce his execution. His hands did not twitch now. Shame and hatred writhed within him like a pair of serpents locked in a death struggle. With a click of finality, the baton of choosing was sealed back within its ceremonial case and borne away by golden-robed attendants.
Erlach Grail,
announced Bartek, his eyes smiling.
No master has spoken for you, yet the fellowship is nothing if not benevolent. A place has been secured for you, one that will, it is hoped, teach you some much-needed humility, and at least a modicum of empathy. In time, perhaps, one of the masters may deign to take you on.
Where?
Interrupted Grail, eliciting murmurs and tuts, but he did not care. Bartek looked down his bulbous nose at him. His expression was that of a man who had inadvertently stepped upon something distasteful.
You will serve as a minor assistant to the Wardens of Thresholds,
he declared, malice gleaming in his eyes. There were smirks and stifled laughter among his former peers. The Threshers, as the student body derisively called them, were the lowest of the low, both literally and figuratively, those who guarded and patrolled the lowest depths of the vaults beneath Helia. Their ranks consisted of those who had earned the ire of the masters, whether through gross political misstep or misdemeanor, and any others whom the Fellowship wished out of the way. Down in the darkness, they could be forgotten. They were a joke, an embarrassment. Bartek's patronizing voice droned on, but Grail barely heard his words. In that moment, he swore that this was not the end. He would serve among the Wardens and ensure that his worth was noticed, such that none of these pompous, sniveling masters or his snobbish peers could deny him. He would serve a year, maybe two, and then he would take his rightful place within the inner circle. They would not break him. And he would remember this insult. Alovedra Camivore. It was dark and cool within the hallowed sanctum of judgment, and Callista appreciated the reprieve from the scorching Camivoran summer outside. Standing at attention, bedecked in form-fitting armor and a high-plumed helm, she waited for judgment to be rendered. Despite being out of the sun, the slender young heir to the Argent throne, kneeling at her side, was sweating, and his breath was shallow and quick. His name was Viego Santiarl Molach Val Kala Higari, and he waited to see if he would be crowned king, or if this day would be his last. absolute rulership or death. There could be no middle ground. He was Callista's uncle, but she was more like an older sister to him. They had been raised together, and he had always looked up to her. He was never meant to be the next king. That should have been Callista's father, the firstborn. But his unexpected death had placed Viego, his younger brother, next in line. The sound of the massed crowds outside was muted within the cold walls of the sanctum. Hooded priests, their faces obscured by shadow and blank porcelain masks, stood anonymous in the gloom, forming a circle. The incense from their censers was cloying and acrid, their whispering chant monotonous and sibilant.
"Carl,"
breathed Viego.
"I am here,"
Callista replied, standing at his side, her voice low. He glanced up at her. His patrician face was long and handsome, yet in that moment he...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.